Dearest brethren, God bless you. Brother Joseph, hi.
Hi, so this is for the brethren in America, and mostly in America and all over the world they speak English, in England too, right?
Yes.
Well, praise the Lord. First of all, God bless you. I'm very sorry that we're not broadcasting in English so much, because what happened, there was an explosion of sheep and people following in Italy, and so now we are concentrating in Italian. It wasn't my choice. Everybody is my witness, because I started in English, right, Angie? I studied in English, and praise God. But then all of a sudden, the Holy Spirit just caused an explosion, because I am originally Italian. Yeah. Even in Italian, my accent is not exactly very Orthodox, Italian Orthodox, but it's more like, you know, when you mix different languages. So the message of today is, I think, a very, very important message. One of the most important messages I ever gave, because it's like it's really, really necessary for what's happening now. We are entering the end time, and like Jesus said in Luke 18:8, when the Son of Man will come, will he find faith on the earth? No. So the mark of the beast is coming, the Antichrist, the one world government. So we need to prepare now to go through the end time. What?
They go to the church, they participate to the activities, but they feel like there is more they want to do for Jesus, and they don't know where and how, and they want to learn about it. So they say, can you teach us, how do you make it to give your life fully, 100% to Jesus, every day you live for Jesus, how do you make it? And they're asking for guidance and teachings.
Yeah, how do we make it? We don't know, it must be Jesus. Fratelli italiani, un po' di pazienza, eh? Facciamo una piccola parentesi in inglese e poi torniamo in italiano, va bene? Così praticate un po' di inglese, quelli che lo conoscono e quelli che non lo conoscono cercano di conoscerlo. Okay, so well, yes, what's living by faith? So well, it's continue when everybody stops, and refuse the mark of the beast when other people will receive it, trust in God when everybody around us deny the Lord. Living by faith means to thank God through sufferings, and knowing that it's the devil sending the suffering, not the Lord. God is love. Faith is like being able to die thanking and praising God, because he considered us worthy to give our lives for his kingdom, like Jesus did. It means to continue to serve the Lord according to the example of Jesus, in whatever happens, whether you're rich or poor, happy or going through pains, when everybody is praising the Lord, whether people are supporting you, maybe they curse you, when your family, your friends exalt you, okay, because you follow the Lord, or when they despise you and they're ashamed of you, when they call you heretic, etc. So, this is faith. Faith is to continue when people stop. Faith is to serve the Lord when the others are not. Faith is when the mark of the beast comes, you refuse it. Faith is when the whole world follows, like yesterday, they were following Nazi communism, this and that. Soon they're going to follow the Antichrist. We need to follow Jesus, serve the Lord. That's what faith is. It's just a little idea. Faith is much more than this, right, Angie?
Oh, yes. When you have to actually put it in practice every day, you realize it's much more than just... I know Hebrews 11 gives a great definition, really inspiring, uplifting. But when you have to put it in practice, there is a lot of desperation and getting on your knees. But it's worth it, because it gives you great, great satisfaction.
Yes. Amen. Lord help us. So, dear brother in America, wherever you are, I want to send a special greeting to Natasha, because she always writes to us, and a bunch of others are writing. And we love you so much. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. So pray for us, brethren, and pray that that we can produce more and more in English. Here, Dora,
yes.
She really loves you. She's translating in English,
yes.
Right, Dora?
Yes. Yes, right. I do.
Okay, so we better stop here, and we go back in Italian.
Yes, because they're waiting on us.
Right?
Thank you, Brother Joseph. Thank you for giving this greeting to the dear brethren. God bless you.
I love you. Praise the Lord.
Okay, I'm going to go on my plow now and translate from Italian into English this message about faith. So Brother Joseph is asking Angela, so where do we start from? We start from the brethren who wrote to us. And we're going to read some messages that they sent to us. And they are the ones that provoked this message. And that's why we're going to start with their message. We are starting from Alessandro. He wrote to us from Switzerland. Alessandro says, dear brethren, I ask you to please pray for me. I feel tired. I see things in my church which I don't like. I don't know if the problem is me, my mind, and I have to fight against it, or if it's something actually that it's against God's word. I believe that the brethren need to help each other, that the priority needs to be the love for the brethren. Maybe I am just more sensitive about this subject, but honestly in my church I don't see much love, and I feel alone, and I feel sad. I give an example. 2 weeks ago, me and my girlfriend split. We gave up on each other. Actually, I left her because she was not growing in the faith at all. We knew each other before I grew close to the Lord, but then afterwards she decided not to get close to the Lord with me. She decided to stay away from the Lord. I think the marriage is a very important step. And I did not receive any confirmation from the side of the Lord concerning my girlfriend. That's why I left. I decided to let her because she was not growing in the faith. The point is that since she left me and we split, nobody from church came to see how I'm doing. How am I doing? How am I taking this decision? Do I feel lonely? Do I need prayer? Nobody came to ask me how I am. And it's not the first time that this happens. Nobody asks you anything in the church. Everybody's concerned about the technical things of the church, but nobody's interested in the people, in the brethren. I see that priority is wrong in our church. We spend money for the music, for the lights, for the computers, for the TV shows, but we don't spend money for the evangelization. I don't like these things that I see in the church. The Lord is working in my heart. I started a Bible course and that's helping me a lot. I heard many of Brother Joseph's teachings and my eyes are being opened. I want to be a testimony and a disciple of Jesus in my church as well. But I don't want to make compromises anymore. I want to be a disciple of Jesus. I think I am at the crossroad, and I know the road which I have to take. It won't be easy, but I chose it. Pray for me. I need you, my brethren. Even if we are at the distance, I feel you close. God bless you, Alessandro. End of message. Even though we are distant, we still need to be close to you, brother. And we want to be close to you, and we are praying for you. You know, many brethren are starting to come to South America, and we're going to be together even physically. Concerning this church, your church, Alessandro, I want to pray for it. I want to pray that your pastor and your brethren there can be filled with love. I want to pray for them that the Lord will give them the grace to take care of the sheep. In his message, Alessandro also said that my pastor went in vacation and he never phoned me or took care of me or asked me how I'm doing or prayed for me. So Joseph is saying he is blessed. He's going in vacation. I never took a vacation in 43 years. You know, I want to tell you, brethren, that I am against the worldly vacations. When you go and you put your shield down, and you just go and do nothing and just get suntanned. And what do you do for Jesus in this vacation? So I'm against this kind of vacations. mean, there are some articles about people who go on vacations. People on the beach are being attacked. Some cruise ships also are being, they sank. So in our church, brethren, it's almost like, I want to say that there is no time for vacations in our church, in our fellowship. Okay, you can go on the beach evangelizing. Maybe you go on the beach but go witnessing. And then when you have a few minutes free, okay, take a swim. But keep your eyes open for the sheep, okay? Keep your eyes open for the sheep. The devil is never in vacation, okay? The devil is never in vacation, says Angela. We always need to be awake and alert. Joseph said, I've been in the Italian coast, Mediterranean coast, and you know I haven't seen the devil there in vacation. Not the devil, not Jesus is going in vacation. You know, I took a decision to do a little vacations every day. Take a little walk, read a little bit of Bible, take a little relaxation every day, and that's it. We are here in the countryside right now, and the sunset and the sunrise are so beautiful. A beautiful painting from the Lord. And that's vacation, looking at the sunset, spending some time with Jesus. So I'm praying for this church. I'm praying for this church that the Holy Spirit will fall on it, and that they will be able to understand also the end time prophecies. Because if you understand the anti prophecies, you won't have time for vacations. Angela, next message from another brother. Let's call him A. And the brother says, peace unto you. I speak to you. I want to write to you and speak to you a little bit about something. I'm the elder in a church in the house, 15 people. And I'm teaching them about the end time. Joseph intervenes and he says, that's wonderful. 15 people in house church, that's the best number. Wonderful. Angela continues with the message. In the church from which I belong, nobody talks ever about the end time. They just talk about the prosperity. And they always talk about giving, giving, give more and more and more. And if you don't give, if you don't give, God will not bless you, they say in my church. It's a big church, some 3,000 people. But I go to another little church of 150 people. So this brother doesn't go to his church where he belongs, but he goes to another church of 150 people. Plus he has the house church, 15 people. So he belongs to a 3,000 people church, but he actually goes to another church of 150 people, but he gets together with 15 people in his own house. I see that in the church people favor each other and there are compromises, and I don't share many things of what they are doing. The pastor is little in the church. He doesn't come much to church. He's always around traveling, but he doesn't take care of his church. Me and other people have to take care of the church and of their needs. Will you, Brother Joseph, give me some counsels about this? I thank you so much that you exist, brother. Peace be unto you. So, he wants some counsels, right? Yes. He wants some counsels. Joseph is saying, wow, a church of 3,000 people, what kind of a church is it? These churches are unscriptural. Unscriptural because you need the building after building after building. You need the permissions from the state to have so many toilets, this and that. This is not scriptural at all. The only good thing in these big churches is that they collect a lot of money. There are not many other advantages about this. There are many disadvantages about it. Many disadvantages. This will be, it's like a ball and a chain. This kind of big churches are a ball in a chain against the evangelization. They don't have time to evangelize because they need to take care of their big church. In the Bible, in Corinthians, Philemon, it talks about the church in your house. The church in your house, 10, 15, 20 people in the house. Somebody should go to this pastor and tell him, "Dear pastor, with all respect, I want to tell you, this church is not biblical, okay?" Acts 7, 48, it says that God doesn't live in buildings made with hands. Acts 5, 41, and so on. The church needs to be the way Jesus did. A few people getting together, praying, evangelizing. Also because the end time is here, and this building soon will be forbidden. You know, Russia already passed a law that you are forbidden to pray in your house, and you are forbidden to evangelize. So let's wake up. Let's go to these pastors. We love them. We love these pastors. God bless them. But let's go and warn them. Let's help them. They are out of step, these pastors. The message of the day is how to live by faith. But somebody entered the studio. We have a visitor. His name is John. He's 6 years old, and he came to visit us. What do you have for us, John?
Yeah, I only have 3 scriptures.
All right. Go ahead. Allora, vuole citare delle scritture. Va bene, John. Go ahead. In inglese. Pensi tu tradurre, Angelina.
Okay. Reference?
John 3:16.
Okay.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, and whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life.
Questo è stato Giovanni 3:16. Poiché Dio ha tanto amato il mondo che ha dato il suo unigenito figlio affinché chiunque crede in lui non perisca ma abbia vita eterna.
Very good, beautiful, John.
But as many received him, to them gave him power to become the sons of God, even to them that believeth on his name. Behold, I stand at the door knock. If any man hear my voice and openeth the door, I will come in to him and will sup with him and him with me.
Super, very good.
Reference? John 1:12.
Revelation 3:20.
Okay, yes. And the other one before?
John 1:2:12.
All right, wonderful. Thank you.
And this was John, and he entered into the studio and he wanted to quote the scriptures. Praise the Lord. John, 6 year old, the smallest son of Brother Joseph. So let's go to the message. The message of today, it's called Let's Live by Faith. How to live by faith in this end time. How to live by faith in this end time. Luke 18:8. When the Son of Man cometh, shall he find faith on the earth? Which is the answer? No. The answer is no. Angela says, the Bible actually answers that there will be the falling away of the faith, the apostasy. Joseph is saying yes. Just look at the churches today. They are all only interested in money, homosexuality, and so on. Brethren, the 666 mark is coming, and the Antichrist regime is coming. Let's prepare now to overcome these things victoriously and to be able to go through it with victory, with faith, to be able to go through this with faith. What does it mean to live through faith, by faith? What does it mean, this? Well, let's go to Habakkuk. Habakkuk, I think it's chapter 2. Habakkuk 2:4. Behold, his soul which is lifted up is not right in him, but the just shall live by his faith. So the just shall live by faith. Habakkuk 2:4. There is the soul lifted up. The religions are lifted up. They're lifted up, but it's not right in the sight of the Lord. But the just shall live by faith. Today there are religions which are just lifted up in themselves. They lift up themselves, their religion, their church, and so on. But they don't live by faith, by His faith, the faith of Jesus. They don't live close to the Lord. Today, what is the faith? Faith is to continue when everybody stops and they don't want to continue for Jesus. You continue. The mark of the beast is coming. The whole world will go after the beast. What is faith? To refuse this, to refuse the mark of the beast. That's faith. Faith is to smile to God and to trust in Him when those around us are denying God. You trust in Him. What is faith? To suffer and to thank God for the sufferings, knowing that it's not Him, but the evil one that sends it, because God is love. What is faith? Faith is to die thanking, to die praising, because He is with you. To praise the Lord that you are counted worthy to die for Him. That's faith. Faith is to continue to serve God, just like Jesus did, serving Him in poverty or in riches, to serve Him in joy or in pain, to serve Him when everybody praises you that you serve Him, or everybody curses you that you serve Him, to serve Him when your family and your friends are proud of you, or when they despise you because you follow Him. Matthew 12:24. But when the Pharisees heard it, they said, "This fellow does not cast out devils but by Beelzebub, the prince of the devils." They accused Jesus that He was casting out devils by the devil. Today there are churches which don't believe in this. They say that if you do a miracle, it's not from God. They don't believe in miracles. Matthew 10:24, the disciple is not above his master, nor the servant above his Lord. It is enough for the disciple that he be as his master, and the servant as his Lord. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebub, how much more shall they call them of his household? Matthew 10:24-25. In other words, us, we shall be called the same. Prepare yourselves. Prepare yourselves to be despised. If you look around you, you see that the end time already started. And who doesn't understand it is because he has blinders. The spirit of the Antichrist is all around. The spirit of the Antichrist is even in the churches. He has prophesied. 1 Timothy 4, from 1 up. 2 Timothy 3, 1. And in continuation. It's important that we learn to live by our faith in Christ without counting on the support of the national churches, because the majority of them will submit themselves to the Antichrist. That's why I don't count on them. Nowadays, most of the churches are submitted to the state, to the government. They are submitted to the state. Just like in Hitler or Mussolini times, they are submitted to this government in silence. They were submitted in silence. We shouldn't do like that. We should do like Jesus. What did Jesus do? He evangelized without the permission of Pilate. He went evangelizing. We see the hierarchies today in the traditional churches. They are becoming more and more secular. Homosexuality is entering in. They are becoming more and more on the side of the Islam. Why? Because they are not close to the Lord. They are more and more into money. They preach the gospel of prosperity. So that's why you cannot count on the official churches. Our walk of faith starts with this. start being a church wherever you go, wherever you are, starting with your home, okay? Start your walk of faith by living by faith in your house, having a church in your home. Who doesn't know us very well, I tell you this about us. This is us. Our blueprint is the following. We are a worldwide fellowship of the Spirit, of the Lord, composed of many little churches of brethren who reunite themselves, in their own houses. This is how our fellowship is formed. Our fellowship is formed of believers who get together in their houses and have church in their homes. Our fellowship is formed of little house churches. And if we do this, the devil will not know where we are and will not be able to persecute us so easily. Because today we meet in your house, tomorrow we meet in my house, tomorrow we go in Vanya's house, and so on, and we get together and we pray, and the devil doesn't know where we are, so he can persecute us. You know that buildings, these church buildings, are not from the Lord. They are not in the Bible. These things are actually a ball and a chain against evangelization. When you're stuck in a building church, you are not so free to go evangelizing. A couple of people control that building, and that's it. It's a waste of money, such buildings. Study the following scriptures. Acts 7:48, Matthew 24:1 through 2, 1 Corinthians 3:16, John 4. Which is the true church? The true church is the bride of Christ. The true church is his body. One body, united, not divided, not sectorized in Catholic, Protestants, Jehovah Witnesses, Evangelical, Mormons. No. These names in the Bible don't exist. I believe Jesus loves all the believers, independently of their denomination, independent of whatever parish they belong to. God loves everybody. I believe that all those who receive Christ as their only Savior, they are part of his body, and they are part of his church, and they are our brethren, evangelical, Mormons, whoever. If they accept Jesus as the only Savior, they are our brethren. Point. And that's it. I don't care what religion they belonged to before. They are my brethren if they accept Jesus as the only Savior. Praise the Lord. Give me a scripture. 1 Corinthians 1:10. 1 Corinthians 1:10. Now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you all speak the same thing, and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. Amen. One can be a Laodicean Christian, but he is part of God's body, of Christ's body. So all these names that we hear around are not in the Bible, okay? All these names we hear around of denominations are not in the Bible. How do you recognize the true church of God? John 13:35. By this shall all men know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. Not because you follow Mormonism or Catholicism, but because you have love. Okay? That's how people will know if you're Christian or not. Angela saying, considering that this is the answer for the end time that's coming, living by faith is the answer for the end time that's coming. Angela is asking, how do you organize a church in your home, in your own family? What does this mean? What does it mean? Because when somebody thinks the word church, they think of all the organization that needs to be done, of the benches, of the organ that's singing, of the statues that you need to put around and so on. What does it mean? No. Joseph says, no. You don't need any of these things. You don't need any of these things. What do you need to have a church in your home? Nothing except the fact of receiving Jesus in your hearts, okay? That's all you need. That's all you need. If your husband or your wife believe in Christ, Matthew 18:20, if we are united together in His name, He's together with us in the midst of us. In the midst of us, Matthew 18:20. Two or three united in His name are a church. Okay, forget your building, Catholic, Evangelical, Mormon, or whatnot. Let's call each other brethren. Forget your denominations. And let's unite together just in His name. Where two are gathered together in His name, there is Jesus, if we love Him. So how do you organize a church in your home? First of all, we need to be careful not to fall in the condemnation which the traditional churches will throw on you, okay? Today, some of the churches are like political parties. These churches today are jealous. They are jealous, and they are offended if you do a church in your family. They think of it as a competition instead of look at it as a blessing. They should take a look at it. They should look at it as a blessing. You know, when the end time comes, some of these brethren from these state churches are going to come looking for you and are going to want to get together with you in your home. They're going to say, oh, our pastor took the mark of the beast, so I see that it was wrong to get together in the church building, traditional building. Can I follow the Lord with you? Galatians 5:1. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ hath made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Galatians 5:1. So be careful at the political parties and at the religious parties. Don't let them take away your liberty. Don't let them entangle you again with the yoke of bondage. All the churches are sects. There is only one church which is true, the Church of Christ. Wherever you gather together in Jesus' name, you are the Church of Christ, belonging to Christ. Galatians 1:7. There be some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ. Verse 8. But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. Galatians 1:7-8. In other words, anathema, accursed. So these gospels, quotes, preached in these churches are not right. They are accursed, okay? And I didn't say the Bible says it. Just preach the gospel, not your traditions, your religions, your political party. So, how do you organize a church in your family, in your home? How do you do it? Well, pray together, study the Bible together, evangelize, meet your brethren, organize projects to reach the sheep. That's how you organize a church in your house. Like this, you start it. You start, number one, by receiving Jesus as your Savior, and second, by giving your heart to Jesus, being consecrated to Him. Love your wife, love your husband. If your husband or your wife is against you, you continue loving them, being a sample of Jesus. Don't cast benzene on the fire so it lights up even more. No, put water on the fire. The water of the love of the word. Sooner or later, the husband or wife will get converted because they were struck. They were struck by your love. How do you want the soup? Like this? Okay, I'll make it for you. How do you want your spaghetti? Extra cooked. Okay, here they are, extra cooked. So, you know, dear brethren, if you cannot stand each other, why don't you make a list of the things that you don't like about each other? And then see that many of those things are just silliness. Just don't look at them. Put them aside and love each other in the love of Jesus, okay? Of course, if your husband or your wife is possessed, then you keep going for Jesus, okay? Don't follow them. Listen, I could speak for half a day about this subject. To know more about it, ask Angela. She will give you the Bible course. Angela will give you the Bible course and you can learn more about it. Angela will not send you money, but she will send you the Bible course for free. considering that in these churches today you have to pay a lot of money for these things, I think it's a good deal you're getting. And you know that proverb? If you like our Bible course, then spread it to your friends. If you don't like it, give it to your enemies. In other words, spread it to your friends or to your enemies, to whoever. 1 Corinthians 6, 19 and 20. What? Know you not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost and you are not your own? You are bought with a price, so we belong to Christ. 1 Corinthians 6, 19 and 20. 1 Corinthians 3, 21 to 23. Therefore, let no man glory in man, for all things are yours, whether Paul or Apollos or Cephas or the world or life or death or things present or things to come, all are yours, and you are Christ, and Christ is God's. 1 Corinthians 3, 21 through 23. Beautiful scripture. Forget all the churches, all the religions, all the denominations. We are Christ. We are free in Christ. We have Christ. We do not belong to this religion, to that religion. In Christ we are free. John says, Jesus says in John 10, 4 and 5, the sheep follow him, for they know his voice, and a stranger will they not follow, but will flee from him, for they know not the voice of strangers. Also verse 13, John 10, 13, the hireling fleeth, because he is an hireling, and careth not for the sheep. So it's our love for Christ that needs to attract the sheep, okay? It's only the out of the spirit churches who try to keep their sheep in the sheepfold with threats. But if we walk in love, the sheep see the love and they come, okay? Because that's the food of the sheep, the love. Officially, I eat bread and cheese and spaghetti. But in reality, the sheep eat love. Love is the food of heaven. We eat love. If you go in love, the sheep will follow you. You don't need to push them in this church or in that church. The sheep want the love of Jesus. If you are a single brother or a single sister, don't ask me to send you sheep there. You know what? You evangelize. You evangelize and you will meet sheep. That's all I did. That's what I did. If you follow the Lord and you go evangelizing, the Lord will add brethren to you. So brethren, don't complain you're alone. Go witnessing on the streets. On the streets there are thousands of people who are alone like you, who suffer of loneliness like you do. And what do they need? They need your love. They need your friendship, not a Bible on their heads. They need friendship, friendship, friendship. And then, slowly, slowly, a little gospel. A little gospel here, a little gospel there. And you explain to them that it's not a religious gospel, but they are a gospel of love. And you see that they will like it. And then you will meet again and you will drink a coffee together and you will eat together and you will read a little Bible together. And then slowly, slowly, you are two and three and four and you are a church. If you are in a situation where your wife or your husband curses you because you follow Jesus, then you go to the sheep house and you read the Bible there. Can you explain to us, Angela says, how do you practically live by faith, okay? We are entering the end time. We are in the end time. How do you practically live by faith? Joseph is answering, well, the spirit of the Antichrist is already here. The front lines of the hordes of the Antichrist are already here, and those are the Muslims. The Muslims are already here, and they are taking over. So we are living in the end time already. That's why the Lord told us, to the brethren of our fellowship, that we need to be spread. We need to be spread around so the devil doesn't know where we are, so we can be more fruitful for him. So the mark of the beast is coming, the tribulation is coming, and we have to live in a private way. Like catacomb style, okay? Like catacomb style. That doesn't mean now that you need to go look for a cave, to live in a cave. There's no time yet to live in a cave. Don't go look for a cave. But live in a private way, in a private manner. John 10, 14 and 15. I'm the good shepherd, and I know my sheep, and I'm known of mine. I lay down my life for the sheep, verse 15. So Jesus is the good shepherd, the true shepherd. So we need to teach our sheep, the sheep, to hear God's voice, to follow him. Because the time comes when this will be vital. So forget going to these churches that only hear from the pastor and that's it. The Catholics have the Madonna and Evangelical have the Madonna. Who's the Madonna of the Evangelical? The pastor. You're always dependent on the pastor to hear from the Lord for you. You know what? You need to hear from the Lord independently. You need to be self-sufficient, hearing from the Lord. You need to teach the sheep to hear God's voice. This is very important, to learn to hear God's voice. Angela says, I think this is a freeing message that you give, Joseph, because this makes us be dependent on Jesus, hear his voice. And also it's for the end time very vital, because you will not be able to go to your official church and hear from the pastor what to do. You will be able to hear from the Lord for yourself and what to do in your situation. And you're not dependent on the church, on the official church. So can you answer my question? How do you practically live by faith? Nitty gritty. How do you actually live by faith? Habakkuk 2:4. The just shall live by faith. And Romans 10:17. Faith cometh by hearing the word of God. So Habakkuk 2:4, Romans 10:17. Let's read Hebrews 11, the chapter of faith. Hebrews 11. Through faith, verse 33. Through faith subdued kingdoms, wrought righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouth of lions, quenched the violence of fire, escaped the edge of the sword. Out of weakness were made strong, vexed valiant in fight, turned to flight the armies of the aliens. Verse 35, women received their dead raised to life again, and others were tortured, not accepting deliverance, that they might obtain a better resurrection. And others had trial of cruel mockings and scourgings, yea, moreover, of bonds and imprisonment. They were stoned, they were sawn asunder, were tempted, were slain with a sword. They wandered about in sheepskin and goatskin, being destitute, afflicted, tormented. Verse 38, of whom the world was not worthy, they wandered in deserts and in mountains and in dens and in caves of the earth. And these all, having obtained a good report through faith, receive not a promise. God having provided better things for us, that they without us should not be made perfect. Amen. Praise the Lord. Through faith, through faith, through faith. Today we are talking about faith. Wonderful. Faith overcomes the devil. Faith overcomes the tribulation. Faith overcomes the mark of the beast. Faith makes our lamps full of oil. Faith makes us a worthy bride for Christ. Faith will help us be ready for the rapture like a worthy bride in Jesus' name, through faith, through faith, through faith. This is faith. We are talking today about faith. What is faith? It's not an invisible thing. The invisible faith is false. The true faith, like James says, faith you can see through works. What does James say? James says, you have faith. Bravo! I have works. Show me your faith without works, and I will show you with my works my faith. You know, there are Protestant brethren who say, oh, I don't need to do much for Jesus because I'm saved by faith, and that's it. I don't need to have works. But you know what? The faith needs to show the works. Otherwise, it's not faith. The fact if you have a lamp, how do you call it? If you have a lamp in your hand, but you do not have light in that lamp, what lamp is it? Okay? If your faith doesn't produce works, it's not faith. Yes, we are not saved by works, of course. We are not saved by works, but faith will show works. It's just like my wife. My wife didn't marry me because I do things for her, or I marry her because she cooks for me. No, no, no. She married me out of love, by faith, but now she needs to show the fact. Now she shows her faith, her love for me, by doing things for me, by works. She's doing things for me. She's doing things for me, and like that, she shows her faith and her love by faith, by works. A brother wrote to us, and he said this: faith is beautiful. The word of God is beautiful. Talking about Jesus is beautiful. But in the everyday reality, it's completely different. He said, the everyday problems are difficult, and I do not find any connection between the word faith and the everyday problems. For example, the depths. How do you connect faith with the depths that you have? In other words, you talk about theory, but how do you put it in practice? Well, many times the brethren are writing to us about the financial problems. And this is a mountain which the devil throws at us. And people think it's unconquerable. But it's not like that. Nothing is impossible for God. Okay? Nothing is impossible for God. God, who resurrected the dead, can also resurrect your dead finances, but you need faith for that. Faith put in practice. Philippians 4:19 talks about money. But my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. So my God will supply all your need with his riches. Philippians 4:19. Psalm 37:25. I have been young, now I'm old, yet have I not seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. Matthew 6:31-32. Take no thought, what shall we eat, what shall we drink? Okay, this brother basically said to us in his message, okay, your preaching is good, and the scriptures are wonderful, but how do I apply it in everyday life? How do I get bread on the table, and how do I get out of debt? Okay? My suggestion is for the brethren who have debts. First of all, if you cannot pay your debts, go and talk to some lawyer, a sheep lawyer, a lawyer who's a sheep of the Lord. Ask him for some counsels, how to get out of it. I think an idea it is, I heard, that you can declare bankruptcy, that you are impotent in paying your debts, you just can't. And then... And then they will come and take some of your material things, okay? But I don't know exactly how it will happen, but inform yourself. Ask a lawyer, somebody who loves the Lord. How can you do this to declare bankruptcy? That you actually cannot pay any more your debts and you don't have money and that's it. So after they come and take some furniture away or whatever, after that you will be free. And if you can, move to another country. Check the laws, okay? check the laws exactly how it is if you get out of that country. Inform yourself. How can you get out of that? Maybe by leaving the country, declaring bankruptcy. There will be some laws also in your favor. So my first counsel to you is ask counsel from a lawyer who's a sweet man, and how can you do it? How can you arrange yourself? You know, when I have a problem with my car, I go to a mechanic and I ask him for counsel. This is my counsel for the brethren who have debts. And then the Lord can also make a miracle, okay? The Lord can make a miracle like, and you can get out of your debts. We all pass through financial difficulty, including me. I pass through difficulties. So we all pass through difficulties financially. But in my case, my initial decision 43 years ago to serve and follow the Lord and to evangelize, many times this was my salvation, this decision of mine, financially speaking. For me, always through the evangelization, God provided my needs, spiritual and financial needs. And everybody, all of my brethren can do this. Everybody can do this, can do like I did. You know, you don't go evangelizing because you have money. You go evangelizing because the Bible says so. When I started evangelizing, I didn't have any financial guarantee, okay? Sometimes I hardly had money for the bus fare. It's not that I had the hotel booked of the town where I was going to go witnessing and evangelizing. Don't worry. There always will be a stable of Bethlehem somewhere to take care of you, okay? There always will be a donkey provided for you. There won't be Herod's palace, but a stable you will find, okay? Don't worry about it. The stable will not be perfumed, but at least you have a roof over your head. You know, some brethren came here and they were very spoiled. Where is my cappuccino? We need to do what Philippians 4:12 says. Philippians 4:12. I know how to abound and I know how to abase. I'm happy, content, with or without. And I can do all things through Christ. Verse 13. Philippians 4:12 and 13. So every time I threw myself into the evangelization, I never had a financial guarantee. You know what? If we don't have money, we will not close the shop. We will continue evangelizing. We will continue evangelizing and the Lord will provide sooner or later. Okay? Sooner or later, the Lord will provide if we evangelize. Matthew 6:33. So we are talking about living by faith even if you don't have a financial guarantee. Let's read Matthew 10:7-11. And as you go, preach saying the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Freely you have received, freely give. Verse 9. Provide neither gold nor silver nor brass in your purses, nor script for your journey, neither two coats, neither shoes, nor yet staves. For the workman is worthy of his meat. And into whatsoever city you enter, inquire who in it is worthy, and there abide till you go thence. Matthew 10:7-11. So verse 11, into whatsoever city or town you shall enter, inquire who in it is worthy, and there abide till you go thence. I remember a story. We were evangelizing with a brother in North Italy, and it was evening. It was snowing, a lot of snow. It was very cold. We finished evangelizing in that day, and we were in a resort. We were in a resort, and we thought, okay, let's see here who is worthy. Matthew 10:11. So let's see who is worthy. Let's inquire who is worthy to give us food and to sleep. We were very, very tired and very, very hungry. So we went evangelizing in a restaurant, and right away they said, yes, yes, come in, come in. Oh, you're Christians, you do missionary work, come in, come in. And they fed us. They fed us. And then after we ate, we said, okay, brother, let's go now see, inquire who is worthy to give us a place to sleep. Let's see who is worthy to give us a place to sleep. We thought it was midnight, and we thought, oh, I hope we don't have to spend a lot of money that we have for a place to sleep. But if we need, we will. But let's see if somebody can help us for free. There was a church. There was a Catholic church. So I rang the bell. I rang the bell. It was midnight. It was midnight. Somebody opened the window in pajamas. What do you want? And I said, God bless you, dear priest, dear father. We need a place to sleep. We are missionaries. And he said, no, we are not organized for that. Come back tomorrow morning. Tomorrow morning, I need a place to sleep now. Where am I going to sleep tonight? And he said, no, I cannot do anything for you. And I said to him, okay, before I leave, can I read you a scripture? But you are midnight, do you want to read me scriptures? Well, Father, an important scripture from the gospel I want to read for you. Okay, fine, read it. So I open. I open to Matthew 25. Matthew 25. I read it all for him. Matthew 25. Thirty-two. The Son of Man will come in his glory, and then he shall separate the sheep from the goats. Verse 33, the sheep on his right and the goats on the left. 34, and the king shall say unto those on the right hand, come, blessed of my Father, and inherit the kingdom of heaven prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me meat. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you took me in. Naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came unto me. Then shall the righteous... Then shall the righteous answer him, saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry and fed thee, or thirsty and gave thee drink? When did we see you a stranger and took thee in, or naked and clothed thee? And when saw we thee sick, or in prison, and came unto thee? And the king shall answer and say unto them, Verily I say unto you, inasmuch as you have done it unto the one of least of these my brethren, you have done it unto me. And the priest was listening to this message. I read it all for him. Especially the second part, I think it touched him a lot. Then shall he say unto them on the left hand, Depart from me, you cursed, into the everlasting fire prepared for the devil and his angels. Verse 41. 42. For I was hungry, and you gave me no meat. I was thirsty, and you gave me no drink. I was a stranger, and you took me not in. Naked, and you clothed me. Sick, and in prison, and you visited me not. Then shall they answer him, saying, Lord, when saw we thee hungry, athirst, stranger, naked, sick, in prison, and did not minister unto you? Then shall he answer them, saying, Verily I say unto you, insomuch as you did it not unto one of the least of these my brethren, you did it not to me. Verse 46, then shall they go away into the everlasting punishment, and the righteous unto life eternal. So I read this to the priest, and there was a long silence. He couldn't close the window and leave, because he understood we were not just two beggars. He understood that we were from the Lord. And I was looking in his eyes. I was looking attentively in his eyes. I closed the Bible and there was a long silence. And then the priest said, come in. He got out from the window and the Holy Spirit was upon him. He came, opened the doors, and we entered. And he gave us a place to sleep. He gave us a place to sleep. Praise the Lord. Another testimony that I want to share with you. We were evangelizing with Deborah, and we didn't have a place to sleep. And we were walking. It was late in the evening after we finished evangelizing that day. We didn't have a place to sleep. And we were walking, and we said, Lord, you promised to provide our needs. We evangelized all day. We put your kingdom first. Now you need to provide our needs, and we believe. And we thank you for the place you will provide to sleep. So we were walking, and then we looked up, and we saw in a balcony a couple. And we told them, hi, God bless you. We yelled from down. They were up on the balcony. Hi, God bless you. We're missionaries. Do you have a place to sleep? And they said, you are missionaries? Of course, yes. Come in. Come in. Come to our apartment. So they invited us in right away just because we're missionaries. They gave us a place to sleep. They gave us a place to sleep. And they gave us actually their own bed. They insisted. They said, you are teaching us about the Lord. We want to give you your own bed. Sleep in our own bed, in our own room. Take care. We'll take care of you. And the Lord provided. We evangelized them, and the Lord provided to all our needs. Don't be afraid to put the word in practice. It works. It's alive. Amen. Amen. So in every village that you enter in, Matthew 10:11, inquire there who is worthy, and there abide till you go thence. Brother Joseph, when the brethren evangelize, how should you present yourself? When you evangelize, how should you present yourself? Okay, they cannot go and say, I belong to church so-and-so, because we tell them not to go in the name of a church. So how should they present themselves when they evangelize, since they don't go in the name of a denomination? Brother Joseph is answering. For example, us, in our fellowship, the brethren who finished the Bible course, the free Bible course which we give, I hope that they finished it. Those who finish the Bible course, you can say that you are a missionary in training. You are a student learning to be a missionary. So basically, you can tell them, I am a student studying to be a missionary, and then you evangelize them. You don't go and say, give me food to eat and that's it, like a beggar. No, you evangelize them. Okay, you evangelize them. You evangelize them, and the sheep will take care of you physically as well. It's just like we have taught you in the Bible course. Do not go in the name of a church. The same, don't go in the name of Radio Blast or in the name of the Fellowship of the Church of the Spirit. No, you go in the name of Jesus, and that's it. You evangelize them in the name of Jesus without denominations, and that's it. And then they will listen to you. You go in the name of Jesus. The sheep will listen to you. Because if you go and present yourself, if you present yourself as part of a group, the sheep might get scared. Don't go in the name of a group. Go in the name of Jesus, and sheep will open their hearts to you. Yes, you can talk about the radio afterwards. Of course, you talk about the Radio Blast eventually, so they can also listen to the radio. You can tell them about the Bible course and whatnot, yes, but not in the beginning. In the beginning, just say, you're a missionary in training. Take all the materials that we have free on the radio and distribute them, the CDs, DVDs, the tracts. Go and distribute them on the streets, in the squares, in the houses, everywhere, in the bookstores, everywhere. Go and distribute them. Go distribute without fear. Go on the attack and overcome. In the book of Revelation 2 and 3, It says all the time, he who overcomes, he who overcomes, he who overcomes. Overcome, overcome and win that soul for Jesus and you win, okay? Don't forget that you have the sword of the word, and the devil has nothing. He just has a fork of lies, okay? You know, it's this war with the devil, it's not fair. You know why? Because Jesus always wins and the devil always loses. That's why it's, quotes, unfair war, because we're always winners with Jesus. And you win us, and you evangelize, and you win that soul for Christ. Okay? You know, like a sailor? You're a sailor for Christ. You represent Christ. You're a sailor, like a, I don't know how you say in English, I'm sorry, brethren. Like somebody who goes around, for example, you're a representative of the Bosch company, and you go around trying to distribute batteries. You are a representative of a certain company. You try to represent their products, and you try to sell the products. And you are the same, spiritually speaking. You're a representative of Christ, and you go around distributing the materials of Jesus, of the gospel. Okay? You distribute tracts, gospel tracts, DVDs, CDs, and learn the humility to ask for a donation to those you evangelize. Those to whom you give CDs, DVDs, and so on, learn to ask a donation. And you will see the Lord providing for your needs. Okay? Because if you don't have the humility to ask a donation to finance your mission, sooner or later you will go in bankruptcy. I give you a scripture, 1 Corinthians 9:6-7. This will give you the faith to ask donations for your mission, okay? So you can continue for the Lord. 1 Corinthians 9:6-7. Or I only and Barnabas have not with power to forbear working? 7. Who goeth a warfare any time at his own charges? Who planteth a vineyard and eateth not the fruit thereof? Or who feedeth a flock and eateth not the milk of the flock? Okay, you cannot always give for free. Because if you give for free all the time, you cannot live from the gospel, okay? Those who do not have a work, good news for you. Good news for you. You have time. You have time to evangelize. Wake up early in the morning. You worked 8 hours for the world before. Now work 8 hours for Jesus. Evangelize, distribute Christian materials. Okay? You feed the flock and you eat the milk of the flock. You feed the flock of Jesus and they will take care of you, giving you milk. You are a street distributor of Christian materials. You know, like having a bookstore of the gospel, of gospel materials. You don't have a fixed building where you have your materials, but you go around. You go around and you distribute the gospel. You know, the Lord will protect you, He will guide you, and He will provide for you, okay? And then you know what you need to do? You need to put aside the tithe for your church, and God will bless you for it. God will bless you for putting aside the tithe for His kingdom. Angela saying, somebody asked, can I take all your materials from your site, distribute them, and then can I give my tithe to another church? You can take everything for free from our site. You can give everything, you can take everything from our site for free. Okay, I'm not jealous, dear brethren. The Lord showed me to give everything for free. Okay, give the tithe to whom you belong to the evangelical, to the Mormons. Go ahead, give the tithe there if you belong to them. But our materials stay for free. You can take all our materials for free. Our our fellowship, our fellowship is formed of brethren who have a little church in their families. And thanks to their tithes and their offerings, our mission is able to go on. The brethren who are part of our fellowship are supporting us, and thanks to them we are able to go on and give all the materials for free to the brethren. Those who love us remain with us. Those who belong to the Mormons go to the Mormons. It's not a problem. But thanks God to these brethren who are supporting with the tithe so we can continue for free. Angela says, so basically, you're saying, Brother Joseph, that evangelization, it's the evangelization is a key for the brethren who do not have a job. Basically, you can be a salesman for Christ, you can be a distributor of the gospel, you can be a distributor of the gospel material, you can be representative of Christ with all the gospel materials, and the Lord will provide for your needs. If you are going around distributing bread, there is a brother who distributes bread around. He is evangelizing around and he is giving materials around. And as he goes around, people invite him in. He eats with the people because he evangelizes. And the Lord provides to his needs. I tell you a story. I was in Argentina one time. And there was a guy in a bicycle, in a special bicycle with three wheels. And in front of his bicycle, he had a little box. And in that box, he had thermoses, 9-10 thermoses. One with cappuccino, one with hot chocolate, one with the other one with cafe, and one with coffee and milk, and so on. And with his bicycle, he was going around from person to person, and he was selling coffees. I took right away a coffee, and I gave him a track. I gave him a track, and he had a big smile on his face, and he was very, very happy guy. This is another way. Go around selling coffees and cappuccino or whatever else you want. You want to sell gum or toothbrushes, whatever you want. With the excuse of selling that coffee, you evangelize. You evangelize. And if a Muslim comes and complains that you evangelize about Jesus, you step on the bicycle and you bike to the next corner and nobody sees you. Besides the coffee, you give the water of the word. The water of the word. John 4, 13 and 14. Jesus answered and said unto her, whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again. And whosoever drinketh of this water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up unto eternal life. John 4:13-14. John 7:38-39. John 7:38-39. He that believeth on me, as the scripture has said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. But this spake he of the Spirit, which they that believe on him should receive, for the Holy Ghost was not yet given, because the Jesus was not yet glorified. So he that believes in me, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. So we have the Holy Spirit, the living water. These examples, bicycle and whatnot, these are simple examples. You, brethren, with evangelization, you can find thousands of ways to evangelize. Like this, you don't need to work for the world and pay a bunch of taxes. 43 years, I do not do this. I do not follow the world and work for the world. Why? It works for me. I put Jesus first and he takes care of me. Okay? I put Jesus first and he takes care of me. So, brethren, who don't have work, you are in advantage. You have all the time in the world to work for Jesus 100%. Tell them, I'm a missionary in training. I'm a student missionary. And being a missionary, you have the right to a donation. Of course, first you better evangelize. You don't ask for a donation without evangelizing. You're going to be a bad sample for Jesus. You evangelize them. You give them Jesus. Maybe you even pray with them. And then if the Spirit leads you, you ask for a donation. Say, thank you for the donation for this material, CD, DVDs. How much? According to your good heart. There is a brother who has 500 little USBs. He bought 500 very cheap USBs, and he puts all the materials on it, and then he gives it around. Take the materials from our radio, brethren. The CD for evangelization, and take all the DVDs that are downloadable, and use these materials, brethren. Use these materials. I repeat, you, brethren, who don't have jobs, if you do this, the Lord will provide. If you evangelize a minimum of 6 hours, for example, the Lord will provide all your needs. At the end of the day, you will have donations to pay for your needs and so on. I know by experience that the Lord provides. But of course, you need to roll your sleeves and start early in the morning, as if you would have had the work, normal work in the world. Okay? As a missionary, you will work less than if you worked before. No, you shouldn't. A question. Angela saying, somebody might ask you, but you have permission to sell this? Do you have permission to sell these things? Do you have copyright rights? Are you paying the taxes on these things? Sometimes maybe somebody will ask you these questions. Joseph answers, you mean if you go to a house and somebody says, I am Matteo Renzi? Yes. Yeah, be careful of the taxes of Caesar. I remember sometimes a police was stopping me and was asking me, do you sell these materials? One time a policeman even saw me taking the donation from somebody. And he asked me, what do you sell? What do you sell? This question is like a trap. If they ask you, what do you sell? It's a trap. Because if you sell, you need to have a license, right? And then you need to give the receipt because you sold. And then you need to pay the taxes and so on. So I had to be very careful how I explain clearly. I was telling them, I'm not selling anything. I was saying it's a voluntary donation. And I had to insist and explain clearly, I do not sell. The gospel is for free. I'm not selling anything. I do not sell anything. And I was evangelizing the policemen. So be careful of this, okay? Just explain you're not selling anything. And for example, if somebody cannot give you a donation, make sure you always give something for free, the truck. Give it for free so the gospel can always be free, okay? Okay, you cannot always give DVDs for free to everybody, but the truck, yes. And explain that you do not sell anything, that the donations are voluntary. Insist this, that the donations are voluntary. Angela's asking, if the authorities forbid us to evangelize, what do you do? Joseph is answering, well, Russian French already is in this. Russia and France are already doing this. They are forbidding to evangelize. And more, I think it will be like that. The homosexuals will complain, and Muslims will complain, and the authorities will forbid it. When they come and forbid you, it's important that you cooperate with the authorities, okay? Show to the authorities respect, and tell them that they are ministers of God, okay? The Bible talks about that, Romans 13, 1 through 5. Show them Romans 13, 1 through 5, that they are from God, that the police is, the authorities are from God. And tell them that the Bible speaks about them. And the carabinieris will be pleased to hear. Show them Romans 13, 1 through 5. Don't act strange with them or do something wrong. You know what? Your cooperation with them will touch their heart. Don't show them your contradiction. Don't show them that you are against them and that you don't want to submit to them. Don't show them that, okay? Be very careful how you treat the authorities. Be careful how you treat the Antichrist authorities, okay? Jesus talked about it. Jesus talked about how to behave, okay? Jesus talked about how to behave with the authorities. And we will read it. So make sure you're not contrary to them and start arguing with them. Show yourself cooperative to them. Let's see what the Bible says. Matthew 5, from 5 to 48. Okay, read all Matthew 5, but let's excerpt some scriptures. Verse 5, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Verse 12, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. So cooperate, be a peacemaker, be meek, okay, be peaceful. 25, agree with an adversary quickly, whilst thou art in the way with him, lest at any time the adversary deliver thee to the judge, and the judge deliver thee to the officer, and thou be cast into prison. Verily I say unto you, verse 26, thou shalt by no means come out thence till you have paid the uttermost farthing. Jesus forgives you, but the world doesn't forgive you, okay? The world makes you pay to the uttermost. So, while you can, obey the authorities without denying Christ, okay? When you have to deny Christ, then you cannot cooperate anymore. At that point, you go to the forest and you find a cave, and that's it. You cannot cooperate with them so much to deny your faith, of course. Of course you cannot deny your faith. You cannot go and scream to the authorities and say, I am free to evangelize. Why you take away my right to evangelize? No. Use wisdom. Be cooperative. Be loving. Plus, you're going to show yourself very unfriendly, and they're going to not like you, the authorities. You need to be loving, respectful, in humility, and show friendship. And that way, you will have their sympathy also, okay? Please make sure you don't argue with them, because it's just going to be worse. With the authorities, you always smile. You are relaxed and you are respectful, okay? I knew a brother, missionary, who was a financial police. And he was telling me, never argue with the authorities. Just always be gentle. Just always be gentle. And say, okay, I cannot evangelize here. You just move place, okay? Go to another place. And that's it. Be cooperative. Let's continue with what the scripture says. What happens if it's very difficult for you to continue evangelizing in that place? If they don't let you continue, then let's see what Jesus says in these cases. Matthew 10:23. When they persecute in one city, flee into another. For verily I say unto you, shall not have gone over the cities of Israel till the Son of Man become. So basically Jesus is saying, they persecute in one city, what do you do? You do manifestations, you go and protest, and you go and accuse the government, okay? You do like the gay pride does, manifestations, and you insult the authorities, right? No. It says, flee to another city, just move, go somewhere else, and that's it. Jesus doesn't say to stay there and argue and enter into a fight so they can put you in prison, no. They persecute you, flee to another city, and that's it. I had instances like this. I moved. I moved the city, I moved the neighborhood, whatever is needed. One time I even moved to another country, okay? I didn't stay there to argue with the authorities. To the point that now I moved in South America, which is a blessed continent because you have one language for many countries and you can move around. You can move around. Don't stay there and argue and waste time, okay? A good counsel is if they persecuted you in a place, it's best usually not to return to the same place. Another counsel I want to give you, if you have to move, try not to come back to the same place, if you can, unless the Holy Spirit guides you, okay? Just go look for new places, for different places, and like this you are a step ahead of the devil all the time, okay? Just move. Move and continue evangelizing. 5, why should we move? Because we are in a spiritual war. A spiritual war. 2 Corinthians 10:3-5. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God, to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations, and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. 2 Corinthians 10:3-5. This is my testimony. I tried it out and it works. I'm not the only one, for sure. Others know more than me and they did it better than me. I'm just sharing what I learned, brethren. It's not theory. I've passed through these things and it works. If you want to do it differently, to fight against the authorities, I don't think it's wise, but go ahead and do it. Why should you fight against the authority? He has the gun. He has the sword. Okay? Jesus just says, go to another city and that's it. Continue evangelizing somewhere else. Don't stay there and fight. Okay? I suggest to you, don't stay there and fight against it. Like in every conflict, you know what's a good strategy? The commando war. The commando war, hit and hide. Okay? That's a good strategy. The commando war was always victorious, okay? Because you hide and the enemy doesn't know where you are. You don't know where you are. You don't know where you are. You hit and hide, and that's it. I mean, just look at the worldly wars. Just look at the Muslims today. They stick their head out, throw a bomb, and they hide. And 500,000 policemen don't find it. Don't find this guy. They're all in alert, but don't find him. This is the negative way of doing things, because they put bombs. But you can do it in a positive way. You go evangelize, and you keep going, you hide. So you can evangelize better if they persecute you. You move. Look at the history. Look at the Viet Cong. The Viet Cong, the same. They were hiding, hitting, and America lost against the Vietnamese. America lost. So the Viet Cong actually won because they were a commando warfare. They were attacking and hiding. And like that, they won. Remember the early church? They were hiding in catacombs. The early Christians were hiding in the catacombs. They were praying in houses, hiding in catacombs. Jesus was doing the same. He was moving from city to city. He was moving from city to city, evangelizing. Look at the early church, how they conquered the world. They were meeting secretly in houses because they were persecuted. And then there were the catacombs. 300 years, Christians were working like this. And they won the Roman Empire with their love, with the Christianity. They were meeting in houses. They were meeting in houses and evangelizing. You know, they couldn't obey the laws of the empire. So they were meeting secretly. Also, another good testimony is the Valdez. The Valdez, they were hiding in the Alps, and they were evangelizing and spreading like that. The Christian, the Catholic Christian Church was persecuting them and burning them at the stake and so on. But they were spreading because they were hiding and evangelizing. They survived. The Valdez survived in the valleys, in the valleys, in the Alps. Let's read Hebrews 11, 8 through 13. You know that there is the commando warfare also in the Bible? How the Bible talks about how our forefathers, the saints of old, survived. They survived by moving around and having this commando warfare. Hebrews 11, 8 through 13. By faith, Abraham, when he was called to go out into a place which he should have afterwards received for an inheritance, obeyed, and he went out, not knowing whether he went. When we came to South America, nobody was waiting for us. We didn't know anybody. We trusted in God. You, brethren, are blessed that we are here. We are here, we are here to receive you, to meet you. You are blessed, but it's our duty to help you with what we can. We can omit to offer, but what we can, we will do. What we can do, we will do. We will help you with counsels. We will help you with counsels and whatever we can, spiritually speaking. You are blessed. When we came, we didn't know anybody. We came by faith. So Abraham went, not knowing whether he went. 9. By faith he sojourned in the land of promise, as in a strange country, dwelling in tabernacles with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise. 13. These all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, and were persuaded of them, and embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. Hebrews 11, 8 through 13. Praise the Lord. So, brethren, we have to understand that we have to be like this. We have to be pilgrims and strangers on the earth. We have to be pilgrims and strangers on the earth. We have to be pilgrims and strangers on the earth. We have to understand this, okay? And like this, they were able to escape all the persecutions. Let's read about Jesus. John 5, 12 and 13. So John 5, 12 and 13. When they asked him, "What man is that which said unto thee, take up your bed and walk? And he that was healed wist not who was it. And Jesus had conveyed himself away, a multitude being in that place." John 5, 12 and 13. So Jesus conveyed himself away. He went away. He Let's read another scripture. John 11:54. And Jesus therefore walked no more openly among the Jews, but went thence into a country near to the wilderness, into a city called Ephraim, and there continued with his disciples. So Jesus went into another country. He walked no more openly among the Jews, it says. So John 11:54, we read about Jesus. John 5:12-13, we read about Jesus also. So Jesus conveyed himself away. He walked no more openly. And then it says he continued with his disciple in another place, in the wilderness. So Jesus did it the same. Jesus did the same. Move. Hide, move, and do better for Jesus. Evangelize. 2 Timothy 3:12. All that will live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. So prepare for persecutions. The protection will be in moving, hiding, going to another city, fleeing. That's where the protection will be. Look at the gypsies. The gypsies were never annihilated because they were always moved. Nobody could eliminate the gypsies because they were always moving. They are always moving. Read Acts 8:1-4. It talks about that the disciples were scattered and they went everywhere preaching the word. Read the book of Acts 8:1-4. Matthew 2 also. The Lord appears to Joseph and tells him, arise and take the young child and flee into Egypt. Matthew 2:13-14. Read these examples. Matthew 2:13-14 and Acts 8. I think it's very important what you're teaching, Brother Joseph, says Angela, because this commando warfare is very fruitful. It's very fruitful, the way we do as well. The devil doesn't know where we are, how we do it, where we do it, and we are very fruitful for the Lord. I teach you the same, brethren. Don't invite people to your house until you know the real brethren. Then you invite them to your house. Otherwise, invite them outside in a coffee shop. Learn to live by faith now. Learn to live by faith now because the times are going to come very difficult. Persecutions are coming and they will persecute you and tribulation is coming. That's why it's very important, brethren, now to put the oil in your lamps. It's important you learn to live now, to live by faith. Chaos is coming, okay? Wars are coming, nuclear wars are coming. If you can get out of Europe, get out, and also United States. Very difficult times are coming. In Syria, Russia and America are there. Russia is supporting Assad in Syria against the rebels. Rebels are on the side of the United States. United States are helping them. They could even kill each other directly in Russia, the Americans with the Russians, okay? Wars are coming. In November, there is elections in the United States. Hillary Clinton probably will be elected. She's half a devil, this Hillary Clinton. Hillary Clinton, I think, is a pawn in the New World Order's hands. Trump is not a man of the New World Order, and I don't think he will be elected. I think Hillary Clinton will be elected. Even though he's favorite, Trump, he will not be elected. So Trump probably will not be elected, according to how I see it. I think Hillary Clinton will be elected. She's very antichrist. She already declared that she's ready to make war with Russia. So basically, if she will be elected, and she should be elected, as soon as she will be elected, I think wars will start. Atomic wars are coming, okay? in Norway, Bill Gates, right now, you know what they're doing? It's official videos on the net. Bill Gates and other people in some mountains in Norway, they are stacking away seeds and whatnot because they are expecting nuclear wars, okay? If you read Revelation 6, Revelation 6 talks about this. Let's continue. So, I repeat, blessed are the brethren who can get out now before there is the chaos, okay? And don't stay there trying to get more money. If you have enough money to leave, leave. Don't stay there to make more money. Okay, do what you can and leave right away because great wars are coming. There was a sister who wrote to us saying, I can't listen to your messages anymore. You're always talking about the end time and the nuclear wars and whatnot. From now on, I don't want to hear this anymore. I want to go to my church and worship God, and that's it. But I think this sister came back, and she's listening right now. And she was always sweet, even though she said that she doesn't want to listen about the wars anymore. But as far as I know, she came back, and she's listening to the messages. But I want to tell you, I want to give this example of this sister. Let us not do this, okay? Let us not stick our head in the sand and pretend that nothing is happening and ignore the word, okay? Let's not do like the ostrich does, okay? Let's not do like the ostrich. But let's be awake and like let's be a sentinel. Habakkuk 2, 1 through 4. I will stand upon my watch and set myself upon the tower, and I will watch to see what Jesus will say unto me, what God will say unto me, and what I shall answer when I am reproved. Verse 2, and the Lord answered me and said, write a vision, make it plain upon tables, that he may run that readeth it. For the vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end it shall speak and not lie. Though it tarry, wait for it, because it will surely come. It will not tarry. Behold, his soul which is lifted up is not upright in him, but the just shall live by faith. Be careful at the churches whose heart is lifted up, okay? They lift up themselves. Be careful at these churches. You live by faith, okay? The just shall live by faith, Habakkuk 2:4. Because if we do not obey the Lord, we will be punished with the wicked, okay? We will be partakers of the sins. Just like Lot's wife, she didn't want to listen and she stayed there in Sodom, a statue of salt. Because the Lord says clearly, Revelation 18:4, and I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people, that you be not partakers of her sins, and that you receive not of her plagues. My people, Christians, if you do not get out, you will be partaker of the same sins of the devil. And second, you will receive the plagues. Listen. Jesus is saying, be careful, you are living like people who lived in Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Wake up, wake up, wake up, otherwise you will be partaker of the plagues and of the sins. It's just like the Christians who were there when ISIS came. ISIS came and killed them and cut off their heads. It won't be so easy, okay? Get out. One brother told us, you know what? I'm not afraid to die. You know what? It's not a matter of dying here. You silly. I tell you with love. Wake up. It's not about you dying. It's about putting the mark of the beast on your kids, giving you the mark of the beast or the mark of the beast to your kids. Wake up, brother, sister. Okay? It's not a matter of dying here. It's a matter of tribulation and mark of the beast. Let's wake up. God bless you, brethren. God bless you, all of you who are faithful and you are testifying of Christ. God bless you all who are faithful and evangelize. We're witnesses of Jesus. You shall be my witnesses, says Jesus, not of Jehovah, but of Jesus. We are witnesses of Jesus, witnesses of God doesn't exist because nobody saw God. We are testimonies of Christ. God bless you who testify of the truth of God. Jesus came in the flesh, and we can see him in our hearts through his Spirit. And I can testify that he's in my heart. I am a witness of Christ. I'm a witness of the gospel. God help us to be faithful witnesses. Amen. Amen. Amen, dear brethren. Amen. I love you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for this message. Lord, help us to learn to live by faith. God bless you, dearest brethren. We love you. You are in our prayers. And we want to thank all of you who make our mission possible. And thanks to your help, to the tithes and offerings that you sent to us, we were able last week to go evangelizing in a school where there were 180 children. We did a theater about the life of Jesus, a gospel theater. At the end, we were able to pray with all the children to receive the Lord in their hearts. We were able to evangelize. We were able to explain to them the gospel. We were able to pray with all of them to receive the Lord in their lives, for them to give their hearts to Jesus, to know the Lord. And they all prayed with all their hearts in unison, all of us. We prayed to receive Jesus. And it was wonderful to evangelize them. Also, the teachers were all participating. They're all smiling and hugging us in the end and thanking us that we were actually able to come and preach the gospel to them. They told us, you sowed the seed of the gospel in our hearts, and we hope that it will grow and that we will be different people. So thanks to you, dear brethren, we were able to do this evangelization, and all our mission is possible because through your tithes and offerings, you make it possible. Anybody who wants to participate and help, there is a donate button on the front page of the radio. You can send your help, your tithe and offering. So like this, the work of the Lord here can continue. We bless you. We love you. May the Lord protect you, repay you for all your sacrifices for his kingdom, and may he guide you in all you do.